5 fearless young orphans. Always 5 acting as one. I'm Chuck.
And I'm Bobby.
And this is the Chuck and Bobby Frantic Movie Review. And the stuff on today's chopping block is Gatchaman. Today, ladies and gentlemen, our topic is Gatchaman, an overview of the original series from 1972 all the way to the movie that came out in 2013 with live-action actors and CGI. The original Gatchaman first started in 1972 in October, and it ended in 1974. The show had Candy Eagle, who was the leader of the science ninja team Gatchaman. They had Joe the Condor, June the Swan, Jinpei the Swallow, and Ryu the Owl.
The fat one.
Yeah, the fat guy. And they also had a cool ship known as the Phoenix, which could change into a fiery phoenix when they wanted to destroy enemies that were very hard to take down.
The members of the Science Ninja team also had individual mecha. Candy Eagle would fly around, true to his name, in a little biplane. Zoro the Condor would go around in an unprofessional-looking race car with trained machine guns. Zinpei, he drove in some sort of a toad-looking vehicle with tank wheels. Zoon always rode in a motorcycle, and Wheel stayed with a sip.
In this series, their enemy was known as Galactor. When you saw crazy-looking mecha spring out of the ground, you always knew who they were from. And so Gatchaman was employed to stop these evil robots from taking over the world. Galactor was ruled by someone who called himself Leader X, a strange creature. And we never did see the rest of his body, but we just saw his head. But anyway, he also had a subordinate, a faithful one known as Burke Katsi, the clown of operations. Katsi always had a very, very, very strong vendetta against Gatchaman, since every time Katsi was sent on a mission to destroy them, Gatchaman would always destroy the mecha that he was in and all the guys that were also in it that worked in Galactor. Joe the Condor's vendetta against Galactor is that they killed his parents. His parents, who used to work for Galactor, defected, and so Galactor got angry and disposed of them. Joe always daydreams of the day he'll destroy Galactor and kill Katsi. And Katsi knows it whenever he looks into the eyes of Joe the Condor.
Candy Eagle's vendetta against Galactor is that his father's plane went missing at sea 14 years ago or so. Ken is convinced Galactor was behind it, and now sets out to destroy Galactor, hoping that his father is still alive. In the middle of the series, you learn that his father is alive, but due to a mistake or so on Ken's part, his father dies, killed by a plot of Galactor. Now Ken just dreams and sees revenge in his eyes, sticking to orders and breaking them if he has to suit his own purposes, and if it has to happen, he will let Katsi get away till the end of time, just to destroy Galactor, which doesn't make any sense. C3, Zoom the Swan's vendetta against Galactor is, well, you know, we're not exactly sure, so if you ever find out, let us know. Zinpei the Swallow is another orphan who is adopted by Zoon the Swan to be the little teeny-weeny brother of Zoon, of course. And he seeks fame and fortune as a fighter against Galactor.
Now, Ryu the Owl is the 5th member, and out of all of them, he is the only one who is not an orphan. He has a dad and a little brother who live in a fishing village, and he visits them occasionally, and they have no clue to the fact that he is actually a member of Gatchaman. Now, it looks like Ryo may have joined Gatchaman just to get free burgers at the snack June. We cannot be sure. But he's a great pilot. And last but not least, one of the other important characters who's practically the 6th member of Gatchaman is Dr. Nambu. Nambu is the guy who always tells Gatchaman when to go out, where to go, and sometimes when the mecha they have to fight is a little bit too much and a little too dangerous, he tells them, hey, don't go. But whenever he says this, it's usually ignored by Ken, who just tells everybody, forget the doctor's orders, let's just go and take this out. And that results with everyone almost dying. And that has happened a few times in the show. Dr. Nambu was also pretty cool. He's pretty smart. Well, for the most part, he's very smart, except for a few mistakes every now and then. But he also is the guy who raised Joe when his parents were killed, and he saved Joe's life as well. Another character in this show who should have probably been the 7th member is Red Impulse and his squadron. Red Impulse was the cool guy who comes out of nowhere and saves the day when you least expect it. Him and his two other pilots that work with him. Red Impulse shows up, and for some reason, whenever he does appear, Ken the Eagle always appears to be jealous of him, because Red Impulse is a better flyer than Ken, better maneuver, and a better fighter. And in one episode, when Ken's whining and moping about an incident that he thought he kills one of his members, Red Impulse shows up, beats him up, and says, "Get a grip, kid. Stand up and fight." Unfortunately, it's kind of depressing because this cool character was gotten rid of about halfway during the show when he is killed by an evil Galactor plot. Especially because it's Ken's fault that this happens and Red Impulse is his father. And that's even a worse shocker. Now, at this point in the series, when that happens, the series goes down just a little bit into a little lull. And you're not sure what's going to happen and where they're going to go with it. But then, after about maybe 5-7 episodes, it picks right back up where it should be, and it keeps going up, up, and
in the last few episodes of this original series, it's a little depressing, a little sad, but still gripping because you'll be seeing some of the characters you grew to like a lot die, including Zoda Condor. But you mustn't feel too bad because Katsai also dies, while Leader X gets away in a cigar-looking sip, and the world is saved because of a unique device which you would have to see for yourself to believe. At this point in time, the series, the way it ended, left us in shock. And then we discovered Gatchaman 2, the unending story of the continuing story. Suck, did that make sense?
I'm not sure. But it is a continuing story. Because in 1978, Gatchaman 2 was born. And that's what it was called, Gatchaman 2.
Evidently, the show's only excuse for its existence was the very much advertised reappearance of Zoda Condor. In the intro, they're saying, "Here's the science center team Gatchaman," in Japanese, of course, "Ken Zo Zun Zenpei Rio." Obviously, the much anticipated return of Zoda Condor was the foundation for this show. And after the first 4 episodes where Zo finally returns to the science center team Gatchaman, the show really struggles for an existence.
Now, for the rest of Gatchaman 2, there are about 3 episodes that are really good. 2 of them capturing the original spirit and spunk of the original Gatchaman. The other, I don't remember it because I just don't. And there were 3 other ones that were not bad. It's just I don't remember what they were either. They were just okay. However, what did save the series for me and Bobby was the end episodes of Gatchaman 2, in which they redo the original ending from the older Gatchaman series, where, once again, Leader X tries to blow up the world, and Joe the Condor goes in there to save the day. But, unfortunately, they pull a fast one on us, and this time Kenji saves the day. Though he doesn't really do a good job.
You think it is all over, but in the first series of Gatchaman, known as Gatchaman Fighter, there is a computer kind of team, I don't know what to call it, is called Leader Z, the computer who made all the mecha for Galactor. And he is now their new enemy, influencing humans to do his bidding. Especially some sort of blue person from planet Andorian. I wonder if anybody saw Star Trek. Anyway, we're not going to waste too much time on Gatchaman Fighter because it's Sector Lemon. From now on out, the show is not even worth describing and the artwork is totally inferior to the previous 2 series. All the plots that we saw pretty much sucked, but you know, if they had done this, we'd done Gatchaman from scratch, like, the world is at peace today, and there no one in the world knows of Gatchaman, and no one in the world knows of Galactor, and then out of nowhere they show up, and it would have been a great Matsumoto-type style plot where they redo everything just straight from the beginning. If they had done it that way, it might have worked. They didn't, and it sucked.
Unfortunately, though, the Japanese probably thought it wasn't that bad, because Gatchaman Fighter lasted for more than 100 episodes, which is astounding. And weird. But anyway, after that poor excuse of a Gatchaman product was over, 1994 came along, and with it, a new Gatchaman show. Actually, it was a miniseries, and Tatsunoko Productions worked with Columbia Pictures to make this cool show, actually. It was actually pretty good, because in this show, instead of lousing it up like they did with the 3rd series, they took from the original Gatchaman series the first few episodes, the little bit of the middle episodes, and the ending episodes to it to make a whole new story. And it actually worked out very good. The artwork was interesting, the costumes were okay, wasn't bad at all, and they kept Joe being cool, and that was awesome. However, there were a few certain problems with this series, such as making June the Swan so much out of character than what she was in the original. And making Jinpei the Swallow a little bit too not quirky, not spunky. He's okay, it's just he's not the best. And his jokes aren't that good either. But the rest of the show was actually pretty good despite those facts. And they even included the Red Impulse characters. So that was freaky awesome. And unlike the original Gatchaman series, Joe the Condor actually lives. But the only thing that me and Bobby can't understand is whether all the team members of Gatchaman die. Because at the end, they're in the ship, and then there's this angel-like character flapping its wings in front of them. So we don't know if they died or lived. But if anyone else does, please tell us in the comments below. Okay. Now, in 2013, Toho Pictures came out with a movie and called it Gatchaman. But I think they should have used their time, energy, and money a little bit better. The first few minutes of this film is actually quite good, because they actually fight one of the original mechas from the first Gatchaman series, the Cattle Roller. And everything is cool, everything's great. And then, after Joe the Condor introduces himself, the show goes to pot and nothing can save it. Not even CPR can revive this poor excuse of a film.
We even tried cremation, and that didn't even work.
Bobby, you cannot use cremation as you burn it to ashes!
Oh, no wonder it didn't work. Now, had they wanted to do a Gatchaman movie, the first thing they should have done was not make it a Gatchaman movie. If you had avoided the issue of everyone being named Ken and all that stuff, and having to deal with the original history of the Gatchaman, this movie might have passed. But they associated it with Gatchaman, and now it definitely failed for historians' books. However, since they did do it as a Gatchaman movie, these are the teens we felt could have been in the movie that were not in the movie. The teens we wish they could have left in the movie, or at least put in there. Number 1, the individual mecha. In the original series, Ken had a cool looking plane, Zo a neat race car, Zoom a cool motorbike, and Jinpei a helibug, which looked kinda like a toke. The individual mecha, individual transportation, was part of the fun. They could have left that in there, but they didn't. Whatever. Death wish number 2, Zo's gun. In the original series, Zo had a cool looking gun, a hook gun, that could be turned into a drill. And that's one of those things we wish could have been in this movie, because they didn't give Zo a gun in this movie. They gave him a sword and his feathers, and that's about it. Darn, that was a cool gun. Death wish number 3, Red Impulse. Red Impulse was a pretty cool character, and as it turned out, he was Ken's dad, who faked his own death and went on a secret mission 14 years ago. And man, they could have put him in there. He was the secret ingredient to make this scene awesome. And they left him out. I mean, dude, you started with the kids. You could have thrown Red Impulse in there. You had the opportunity. And there it went. Well, folks, that's all the time we have for today and all we have to say for the Gatchaman team.
I'm Chuck.
And I'm Bobby.
And this has been a Chuck and Bobby Frantic Movie Review. Da-da! Gatchaman, 命を懸けて飛び出せば、長く日本一の声。